I'm really glad I came today. Linda Mantolini, thank you. I'm still mad at you. She was supposed to be my succession plan at the leadership group and left us about 10 years ago to run Eden Housing. Truly one of the most creative and successful nonprofit home builders in the United States. We're so proud of you. Thank you for your leadership on the Housing Trust Board. And Zoe Lofgren is just a hero to me. What she's doing in New York today, we were together yesterday in DC. Her leadership on meaningful immigration reform is historic. And with her help and guidance, we're not gonna miss this opportunity as a nation. And that's gonna make such a difference in the lives and livelihoods of millions of people who are Americans and whose dream is to become Americans. Sandra, please thank Zoe for us. Art DeGius, wow. When the person you try to model your professional and personal values in life after is the person presenting you with an award, it's pretty humbling. From the first time we met, I thought, he may not know it, he may not want it, but he is my mentor and has been ever since. When I think of Art, I think about real leadership, and real leadership isn't standing on the shoulders of others. It's bending down to lift others up and place them on your shoulders, and that's what Art DeGius does. When Kevin approached me and I thought about what would I like to speak about for the next 4 hours, and yes, we are serving dinner. It was not in any way about an impact I may or may not have had on the Housing Trust. It's the impact that the Housing Trust has had on me. And that's what I would like to share for a few moments with really five key thoughts. Take risks. Make friends. Awake allies, shake opponents, and restate goals. Not quite as clever as C-A-R-L, but I'll do my best. First, take risks. I had to go to another Italian, Michelangelo, who was known to say that my greatest fear is not to aim too high and fail. My greatest fear is to aim too low and succeed. And when we thought about the Housing Trust back in 1998, we wanted to aim too high and risk failure. Linda Mantolini is absolutely right. We wanted to run a campaign. We like running campaigns at the leadership group. Why? Because then everyone is invested in the solution. Not just some. And we polled, and we used the best pollster in California, Jim Moore. And the results came back. And when we asked, do you think that the housing challenges in Silicon Valley are a crisis? Yes, overwhelming. Do you think a housing trust is a creative way to help address that crisis? Yes. And are you willing to tax yourselves to pay for it? No. I've run a lot of campaigns. When the poll says you have 20% support, don't go forward. And we had about 75 folks in that room representing the diversity of our valley. And at the end of Jim Moore's presentation, some wanted to lynch him as if it was the pollster's fault for the bad results. And this young lady came up to me named Leslie, and she said, this is great news. And I thought, wow, what'd they put in your coffee? We don't have to do it like every other region in the country. This is Silicon Valley. We can do it different. Why don't we try a voluntary housing trust? because housing trusts aren't new. At that time, there were 275 housing trusts in the United States. They were all funded by a tax or a fee. Ours was the only one attempted that we knew of, let alone successful, that would be a new model of voluntary contributions, and it was Leslie's idea. So we hired one of the best fundraisers we have ever met, our dear friend, departed Muffy Meyer. And she went out and did 6 months of interviews with leaders, came back with a plan, a really cool triangle about you need one person at 5 million and another two at 2 million and then five at 1 million and 10 at 500,000. And it was really cool and complex and great. And she said, and you don't even mention you're doing a fundraising campaign until you're at least halfway or hopefully three-fourths of the way to your goal. And we thanked her, and we paid her, and we applauded her, and then we ignored her. Because we wanted to take risks. The strategy was, you don't even announce you're running a funding campaign until you're almost done, because then there's no risk if you fail. Instead, we said, let's lay ourselves out there in true Silicon Valley tradition and dare the risk of failure. Up front, not a dime in hand, that we are going to establish a housing trust with a goal, a minimum goal, $20 million in voluntary contributions to leverage at least $200 million in private development within 24 months to help a minimum of 4,800 families. And then in those 24 months was one of the worst recessions that Silicon Valley has ever known. But we took that risk. And 24 months later, we held a news conference, and we had failed. We had not raised $20 million. We had raised $20.6 million. And as you heard earlier, the Housing Trust did not generate $200 million in private development. It has generated $1.9 billion in private development. It has not helped 4,800 families. It has helped 853. Why are we so precise with our numbers? Because those numbers are people, and every person we help matters. Take risks. The second, make friends. A friend of mine, one of our CEOs, is Tom Ayers, and he says, the real job of an entrepreneur doesn't even begin until they tell you no. Make friends. Pete McHugh was on that board of supervisors that you heard about back in 2000. And we had been advocating to Pete and Jim Bell and others on that board for months. Please partner with us. Let's make this a private-public partnership. And after months of badgering, Pete finally called and said, okay, Carl, you've made the request. We'll give you $1 million for the housing trust. And I told him no. I said, Pete, I don't want you to give us $1 million. What I think I heard you say was, Carl, we'll put up a $1 million challenge grant if you can match it with $1 million in private sector funds within 90 days. And there was a long pause on the phone. And then he said, yes, that's exactly what I meant. And we developed that friendship, that bond of what we called our foundation builders, because I hung up with Pete and I thought, oh my word, I have now 90 days. And I started making phone calls and I got a few no's, but a lot more yeses of visionary Valley companies. And I called them with this simple message. The Board of Supervisors is willing to put up $1 million, but here's the hard part. They want us to match it, and they only gave us 90 days to do it. And I need your help. There's five of them, so I'm hoping five companies will step forward at $200,000 each. And that was our foundation builder campaign. And five visionary companies came forward with $200,000 each. And it was a wonderful day. We still have the pictures. Putting up the frame of a house with five members of the Board of Supervisors in their hard hats and five CEOs with their hard hats. If they were actually building that house, those 10 folks, I would not want actually building the house. But funding the house, they were quite good at. And we were able to move forward making friends. The third is to awake allies. A CEO with a real passion at the very beginning for affordable homes was not one we would have expected. Craig Barrett, then CEO of Intel Corporation, who got it from the very beginning and every aspect of it, not just the third for Intel employees and others like them, not just the third for affordable rental homes for teachers and firefighters and others on whom we depend, but he got it for the third for the homeless and those at risk of becoming so. An amazing head and a very open heart is how I describe Craig Barrett. And Craig took on the role with Tony Ritter of the San Jose Mercury News of being our champions on our $20 million fundraising campaign within 24 months. Here's the first call that Craig made to Carly Fiorina, then CEO of Hewlett-Packard. Carly, I gave $1 million to the Housing Trust. I want you to give $1 million. And he called me right after to tell me. And she said, well, I appreciate that your passion is affordable housing. My passion is education and public school teachers. So if you can promise me that my $1 million will go to help school teachers buy homes in the same communities in which they teach our kids, you've got my $1 million. And he said, we can do that. He hung up, he immediately dialed me and said, Carl, can we do that? And I said, Craig, we can do that. I hung up and called the Housing Trust and said, can we do that? And so we established, for at least that amount of money, a program to help school teachers. And we have helped literally hundreds of public school teachers buy homes in the same communities that we entrust them with our kids. The fourth way that the Housing Trust has impacted me is shake opponents. Don't ignore them, but by beating their objections, show them, shake them. One of our CEOs, Debbie Dirsch of Chrysalis Software, says, in all that you do, say, or write, never make yourself bigger by making someone else smaller. And we all have opponents in our lives. How are we treating them? Can't control how they treat us, but how are we treating them? One of our member company representatives, nowhere near the CEO level, they've been so visionary about this trust, but a very smart and caring and influential person at a manager level, to our membership said, when we thought about launching this, and this is a quote, this will be the biggest blunder in the history of the Silicon Valley Leadership Group. It made me think, well, what were the other blunders? Instead of letting that defeat us or shake us, I thought we're going to, in a respectful way, show that you're wrong not to believe in this. That became fuel rather than the bucket of water which that person intended it to be. The fifth lesson that I've learned from the trust is to restate goals. When a person, when an organization, when an elected official, when a company reaches a goal, you don't stop, you set new goals. You restate your goals. Friend of mine, I love that you called the lead sponsor the Ironman sponsor. Thank you for doing that. And the triathlete sponsor, if you look on the back of your brochure, good friend of mine, Australian, named Chris McCormack, is two-time Hawaii Ironman world champion. And he lives by the following words. A dream is a goal with a plan. It's that simple. A dream is a goal with a plan. Lots of people have dreams. Some people have goals. Few people have both linked with a plan. And when you have a big, ambitious goal, whether for him it's to be the Ironman world champion, or for us, the Housing Trust, Kevin Zwick and his amazing team and All-Star Board didn't stop at 20 million to leverage 200 million and help 4,800 families. You heard them today. 73 million invested, 1.9 billion leveraged, nearly 10,000 individuals and families helped. That is amazing. So to Kevin, our hat is off to you and your team. And thank you. Now here's a personal mission, and I believe Art Aegeus will be on my side on this one. We have a new brand. Maybe someone could put it up. Housing Trust Silicon Valley. Housing Trust Silicon Valley. If you look at the periodic table of elements, one of those is silicon. It is not silicon. Please, it is not silicone. That is the San Fernando Valley, not Silicon Valley. So with that rebrand, let's rededicate ourselves to say it right, as I know Kevin Zwick and his team will do. Let me close with this. The Housing Trust has been through hard times, and our state has been through hard times when it comes to affordable homes. I want to go back to restate goals. A new goal is to make sure at the state level that we don't lose those opportunities to build affordable homes. I am so thrilled that my friend and a great leader, State Senator Jerry Hill, is here. An incredibly selfless leader. He, as Democrat caucus chair, just gave up a committee chairmanship that he has a passion and great knowledge around, business and professions. And as a business owner who's actually signed the front of paychecks and not just the back of paychecks, ideally suited to lead in that committee. And his leader came to him and said, would you move from that area of comfort and knowledge to be the new chair of the Senate Environmental Quality Committee, where you get to deal with fun issues like CEQA and fracking and water quality, which will pit all of our traditional constituencies that support Democrats in the legislature potentially against you? Does that sound like fun, Jerry Hill? And he said, yes. We have to support that. Let me give you an example why. You've heard us talk about modernizing CEQA, the California Environmental Quality Act. By the way, a great law that sadly has been greatly abused. We often talk about Netflix. My friend Reed Hastings, who wanted to grow Netflix, worldwide corporate headquarters, my hometown, Los Gatos, California, by building a new development right across the road from their current headquarters, five stories, land already being used, for already built, wanted to build five stories, up, not out. Great lead standard. Sued under CEQA. 900 high-skill, high-wage, high-tech jobs, nothing to do with the environment. Aesthetics. They wanted three stories instead of five. Is that what we intended this law to be about? But here's the sad part and the link to the Housing Trust. There were 165 affordable rental homes for senior citizens to be a part of that project. Those homes will now never happen on that site. They are gone forever. And when we have leaders like Jerry Hill willing to take on a way to build bridges rather than burn them down and bring people together for meaningful modernization of those laws, it absolutely impacts the work of the Housing Trust. So I salute you and I thank you for taking that on. Final note, obstacles are opportunities, aren't they? I love what you have done today with this new scholarship fund. Leslie and I are so honored that you are establishing this with our name in any way attached to help folks in affordable homes go to college. Many of you know that our second child, Sienna, who will turn 4 on May 16th, came to us. Not the old-fashioned way, but through adoption. 1 day old out of a small town in Ogden, Utah. Born to a wonderful birth mom, 17 years old, already with a 2-year-old. No high school diploma, no job, no lifetime partner. Alone in a hospital bed in Ogden. And she entrusted that baby to us at 1 day old. She lives in a Section 8 home. She's now 22 with 4 children, in addition to Sienna, who is ours. Still not married, no high school diploma, no job. Section 8 home, 1 bedroom. 1 bath with her mom, her younger sister, and her younger sister's children. Those are the kids that you're giving opportunities to through this scholarship. So I thank you. Leslie and I would like to take this wonderful start from Symantec and Cicely Joseph for two $2,500 scholarships and round those up with 500 more for each to 3,000 each. We hope we'll be blessed to do that every year. We're absolutely at least committed to doing it this year. And if you're as moved by Symantec's vision for this and the difference we can make for lots of kids, I hope you will consider something on this as well. Thank you. God bless you.